So we're back. There is some issue with Wi-Fi today, and that's the problem. It keeps jumping away from Wi-Fi and back and forth to 5G LTE, and so that LTE is a less reliable overall, but I think today, for the purposes of some consistency, we're going to just go with... what do we do?
Just did it again. Okay.
We're not sure how to solve this problem. So we, like Jordan just said, we just switched. I know we've had a problem with LTE in the past, but our Wi-Fi is definitely causing a problem. We're not finding a way to solve it. So we switched to LTE, but now it's still doing it. So this one might just be jumpy. I don't know what to do.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. I mean, yeah. Less than ideal is reality.
Yeah.
Let's just leave it on here and see what happens. Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to just, we're going to just proceed. It's 20 minutes into the service and we need to proceed, and so hopefully things work as well as they can. You can follow along with at least every third word or every other word. Before I do the brief order of confession and forgiveness, though, I do want to mention one other prayer concern I had mentioned, and this is for Tasha Schweigert. I heard this week that two grandfathers passed away, and so her family is grieving on two sides, and so we pray for Tasha and her families in that. Okay. If you would please turn in your hymnal to page 56. We'll begin there with the brief order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Okay, we will turn to our first hymn today. It's a new one. It's not a hymn. It's a worship song. And I chose it because it fits well with my message coming up here in just a few minutes. So that song is How Great Is Our God. I'm going to get set up.
Just had a long break. Oh, we're back now.
You can unplug it for that period of time. Can we get a thumbs up just that you're catching some of the service?
Jim just said that it was back and working. Okay. So we might just have some blips now and then. I mean, it's better than little blips every 20 seconds, I think. That's just so annoying.
Yeah. But. Right. Jacket on for
the song.
Yeah. So we're going to just... Your patience is appreciated.
We do have some pretty slow transitions. That's okay.
You ready? Mm-hmm. The splendor of the King, holy majesty, let all the earth rejoice. Thank you, worship team. Mm-hmm. All right. Please join with me now in the prayer of the day. Let us pray. God of all who wander in the wilderness, you go before us as a beacon and guide. Lead us through all danger. Sustain us through all desolation. And bring us home to the land that you have prepared for us. Amen. All right. This time we'll have our group of wonderful readers come up and read.
reading is from the book of Isaiah, 4-5, verses 1-7. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Kyrus, whose right hand I have grasped to subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and the gates shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know what it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen, I call you by your name, I surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other besides me. Besides me, there is no God. I am you, I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things.
Today's psalm is Psalm 96, 1-9, 10-14. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered above all gods, for all the gods of the peoples are idols. But the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty all before him. Strength and beauty are his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord the glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is king. The world is firmly established, and it shall never be moved. It will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy. Before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with it.
All right, the second reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. 1 through 10. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers constantly, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. Okay. Work of faith, labor of love, steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. And in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia,
but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report to us about what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. Here ends the reading.
Today's gospel reading comes from Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 through 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted together how they might trap Jesus in what he said. And they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are truthful and teach the way of God in truth, and defer to no one, for you are not partial to any. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to give a poll tax to Caesar or not?" But Jesus perceived their malice, and he said, "Why are you testing me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the poll tax." And they brought him a denarius. And he said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" And they said to him, "Caesar's." Then he said to them, "Render to Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And hearing this, they were amazed. And leaving him, they went away. This is the gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Seems so tight today. Okay. All right, for the message today, I am going to be spending some time in Matthew, what I just read, but we're going to be connecting a little bit to some of the other texts, particularly to Isaiah and to the psalm that we heard today. The title of my message, though, is God is not small. God is not small. That might seem like the most obvious thing you've heard today, or this week, or this month. But I do think that oftentimes the way that we live our lives as Christians, the way that we perceive God as Christians, is really in a very small way. And sometimes, sometimes the more quote-unquote religious we are, the smaller our God becomes, right? You can see where I'm going with this, and I want you to just kind of follow me. In our text today from Matthew, we see two visions of God playing out. Two visions that begin with a vision of God that is actually very small, and it comes to us courtesy of our friends, the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees, I'll remind you, as I have many times, because the Pharisees come up in the Gospels, they're always in this sort of conflict or confrontation with Jesus. So they come up very often. But the Pharisees were, in their own minds, the biggest, most favored, most close to God religious people. In fact, they saw themselves to be the most religious. They followed the law to a T in their minds. They did everything they were supposed to do to be good Jewish followers of Yahweh. But what we see coming out of their own experience and in their conflicts with Jesus himself is that the very opposite becomes true. That the Pharisees, although they were large in their own eyes, religiously, minimized God in reality. They made God a small God. First of all, in our text today, just listen to what happens. Just hear it again. It's almost comical. You can laugh. It's all right. Then the Pharisees went and plotted together how they might trap God. Okay, first of all, if you think you can trap the second of the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, so the Son of God, if you think you can trap Jesus, you're already misunderstanding the size of Jesus in reality. You cannot trap him. But nonetheless, the Pharisees are going to try and do this. And they're plotting together. I can imagine them sitting at a table like this, being like, okay, here's what we're going to do. I want you, Jimmy, to ask him this question. We're all going to kind of nod, and we're going to just be like, there's no way he'll be able to answer it without getting himself in trouble. So here's what they do. They plot together. And they sent their disciples to Jesus along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are truthful." Now, talk about patronizing. So now, not only are they going to try and trap him, now they're going to patronize Jesus. "We know that you're such an amazing religious person. You're so truthful. In fact, you're more truthful than we ever have been. And you teach the way of God in truth." I mean, this is just hilarious. "You teach the way of God in truth, and you defer to no one, for you are not partial to anyone." I mean, I can just see Jesus rolling his eyes. Like, oh, please stop. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to give a poll tax to Caesar or not? You see, here they thought he couldn't answer this question without somehow getting himself in trouble. Right? But the reason that the Pharisees even asked this question, and they think that Jesus is going to get in trouble, because they've already minimized the size of God in their world. Like, the most important thing about being religious is not actually have anything to do with God, but rather it has more to do with the law and yourself. And that's a fatal error that we're going to talk about here in a moment. But that's what they do. And so I give you this sort of picture of God as it comes through the Pharisees. Jesus is going to answer them and kind of trick them. Not trick them, but he's going to do an end around, you could say. But nonetheless, I just want to summarize what they believe God to be in this case. The Pharisees believe God to be naive. They believe that he can be patronized and therefore leveraged, right? If you just pray the right prayer, if you just do the right thing, if you just say the right thing, God is going to be on your side and he's going to help you. You can leverage God against evil in the world, against uncertainty in the world, against fear in the world. We can leverage God if we just pray right, if we just avoid doing the wrong things, then God becomes our tool. How sad is that? He becomes a means by which we get what we want instead of the end that we desire. This is the mistake that the Pharisees make time and time again. So God is not naive. God cannot be patronized. In Galatians 6:7, Paul says, "Do not be fooled. God cannot be mocked." See, the Pharisees here were fooled. Paul was a Pharisee. Paul was a Jewish Pharisee before he had his transformation, you could say, his encounter with Jesus, the risen Christ, on the road to Damascus. And it's in that moment he realized that his whole life as a Pharisee was going in the wrong direction. He encountered the living Christ. He encountered the God of grace. And we'll get to that in a moment. But lastly, God cannot be manipulated. Because God is not small, he is not naive, he cannot be patronized, and he cannot be manipulated. And one author I read this week said it this way. He said, God is dependable, but God is not under our control. You know, it might be a silly example, but I think every summer when you get to that point and your crop is in need of something, whether it be a rain or heat or something you can't control, you've done all you can to grow a crop, but you get to this point and now it's just up to the weather. And I become a little extra religious at that point. Just admit it. I pray as though it's then that when I pray, if I pray hard enough, if I pray often enough, if I pray in the right way, that God will, in fact, send the rain that we need. But I don't think it's quite how it works. I think that deep within that way of being, that way of thinking, is actually a belief that God is smaller than he actually is. That God can be patronized. God, I know I haven't prayed at all in the last month, but you are a great God and you are able to do all things, and so I ask that you would bless my field with the rains that it needs. Now, that can be an innocent prayer, but I'm just being honest with you and telling you that too often, it sounds a lot like these Pharisees here coming up to Jesus and saying, I know you are a truthful speaker. I know that you know God. Tell us. You see what I'm doing there? Prove to me that you're that God. Mm-hmm. Send me the rain that I want. Mm-hmm. So I can have the crop that I want. So I can feel secure in the ways that I want to feel secure. You see? You see what happens? I'm just being honest here. I'm just being honest. If we look at Isaiah, if what we see in the Pharisees is a small God, and then we look at our text from Isaiah and Psalm 96, in Isaiah, it's the story of Cyrus. It's what Alice read earlier. But just listen to these words starting in verse 5. This is how God actually is. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know. From the rising of the sun, and from the rising of the sun, and from the west in the east, and to its going down in the west, there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. Right? That there in Isaiah's prophetic vision is a vision of God as he is. Much greater. How great is our God is the song we sang earlier. How great is our God. And how sad would it be if we could manipulate him. But we don't. But we can't. So we shouldn't. Psalm 96, similarly. Oh, sing a song. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is king. The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. I hear that. how great is our God. The Pharisees had an image of a pretty small God. But God, as he actually is what we read about here in Isaiah and here in Psalm 96. And Jesus begins, he kind of echoes this now in Matthew in a very poignant way. I'm going to go back to Matthew, and Jesus says to these Pharisees who are, again, manipulating him and patronizing him, and they say, Jesus perceives their malice, number one, that's their ill intent. And he says, why are you testing me? Show me the coin used for the poll tax. And they pull out a denarius, and he says to them, whose likeness and inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. And he said to them, then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And hearing this, they were amazed, and they went away. Quite a response. I mean, Jesus just pulls out this coin, or they pull out a coin, and he says this simple thing, and they were so shocked and amazed, and they went away. They were just like, what just happened? Well, what did just happen? Have you ever thought about that? What just happened here in this short and brief exchange between Jesus and the Pharisees? I think what Jesus said in this little object lesson is a reiteration of the first verse we read in Psalm 24. Psalm 24 says, the earth is Yahweh's and all of which it contains. They were trying to trick him by saying, should we pay a tax to Caesar? And Jesus says, it's all mine. The world is mine. Everything is mine. It's the umbrella of reality falls under me. You cannot put me at odds in these kinds of ways. And so he says this in order to give them, to respond to them making God small. He uses this very simple object lesson to say, God is so much bigger than you could ever imagine. Right? And I just love the way that Jesus does this. Now, as we think about this, it's more comfortable if we make God small, right? Like, if Jesus is just like our buddy who will sit with us on the couch and visit. And if we can explain to him how, you know, Jesus, you really ought to be on my team because I've been a good Christian. I've done everything I'm supposed to do. I am, you know, the world is a scary place and, you know, I feel persecuted because I can't do X, Y, or Z in the world anymore. Or we can't pray in school. And Jesus, you know, I just want you to be on my team. That's an insult to Jesus. It really is. And I'm sorry to say that. It's just our way of being like the Pharisees. It's our way of making Jesus, God himself, much smaller than he really is. And you know what it also does? This is what I think is the most important point today. It eliminates the need for grace. The Pharisees' greatest flaw is that they underestimated the place of grace in the human experience with Yahweh. That they felt that the most important thing was to earn Yahweh's love by following the law to a T. But Yahweh's love is not limited to our abilities to follow any rules to a T. It's not related to our abilities to succeed at anything. It's not related to our productivity. It's not related to any of these measurements of what make us successful human beings, good human beings, from an earthly and human perspective. But we do the same thing as the Pharisees did. All the time. Often. I just shouldn't say we all the time. I mean, some of us struggle with it more. I'm just saying that when I say we, I'm probably just saying me. And I'll admit that. But when we think about God as being great, the great God of Psalm 96 and the great God of Isaiah 45 and of Psalm 24, it might make us feel as though God is so distant then. We'd rather have the Jesus on our couch that we can explain like how the way we're doing life is really the way it's supposed to be, right? I mean, like, we've done everything right. You should send the rain on our fields, Jesus. This is how it should work. But it doesn't work that way. And the belief that it does probably is in proportion to the lack of understanding of grace that we have in our lives. You see, this might make us feel distant to see God in this sort of great way. How great is our God? Sometimes it might make us feel distant from God. But the thing that draws us close to God in spite of that really is the missing puzzle piece in the life of the Pharisees and in our lives when this happens is grace. It is grace which draws us close to God. And ultimately, the grace that we see exemplified in the life of Christ as he has these bouts with the Pharisees, yet the quote-unquote worst people he welcomes, the sinners he embraces time and time again. Ephesians, I want to read for you here, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13. Again, this distance. Remember that you were separate from Christ. Strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. And when you were in this place, I should add, editorial comment, it wasn't that you decided then to cozy up to God and use him for your purposes because you were distant from him. No, what happened then, the next verse, is it says, though you had no hope when you were without God in the world, it says, but now in Christ Jesus, who you were formerly far off from, you have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Recognize that importance there. You have been brought near. It's all a passive verb. You didn't do it. You didn't bring yourself near. You have been brought near. Not by anything you did, but by the blood. This is why in a world where, yeah, we feel helpless and we feel like we want control, we feel uncertain, and really control is what we want, control is the thing we need to let go of in order for God's will in Christ and God's grace to become real in our lives, to truly be that center of our lives. Hebrews 10:22, one of my favorites. But there's a lot of verses in here that are one of my favorites. But it says there, let us draw near with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. Let us draw near by what? Not by our good deeds, but let us draw near with a sincere heart by the blood of Christ, which has sprinkled our hearts clean. Think of that. Friends, God is not small. God is not small, and though we oftentimes fall into the trap of trying to patronize God, trying to manipulate God, just trying to get God on our side, and maybe even for innocent reasons, the truth is how we come to really know God is realizing His greatness, and that our connection to Him is by His grace alone. Let us pray. Lord, we thank You today for Your Word that always comes alive every Sunday morning. God, I pray that it would not only be alive in our hearts and minds right now, but that we would take it into the week to come. That we would come to learn more about what it means to serve a God that we can't control, but who nonetheless loves us, cares for us, is dependable, is faithful, and only asks that we give our lives to You, that we surrender our lives to You and recognize that Your grace is sufficient. Lord, we pray this in Your name. Amen. Okay. Did we remain connected?
Yeah. Okay. Seems like it's working.
Good. Okay, so we'll do our final hymn today. Kind of after doing How Great Is Our God, we're going to sing You Are My All in All, which is kind of a response worship song to the message today. Kind of a song of acknowledgement and surrender. And Rose is going to sing with us, right? Rosa chose this one today. This was her. And it worked out perfect with the message. So, Sarah, where's the music? The blue folder.
Oh, she's right here.
No? I was just going to play these chords to like lead in.
My all in all, Jesus.
Thank you again, worship team. Thanks, Rosa.
What?
I said thank you. All right, this time I ask you to join me together as we confess our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, we come before you today. We thank you for the life that you've given us this week, this morning, the presence of family, the presence of friends, the presence of community around us. Lord, we thank you for the resilience and for the strength you've given so many during this time of what is isolation and may even be loneliness at times. We thank you for your presence and for your comfort. We worship you today in the ways that Psalm 96, that Isaiah 45 refer to you as a great God, a God who is God and we are not, a God who is beyond our greatest imagination, our greatest ability to conceive of. We thank you, Lord, that despite that greatness, you have shown such mercy and grace to those of us whom you have created. We lift up your people today and we ask that your people would be a people driven by and built upon grace, first and foremost. That we'd be a people who would reflect to this world a God who truly loves each and every person. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray today for the nations of the world, and Lord, as we have witnessed again another fourth, I'm not sure which wave of the coronavirus now taking over, causing cases to explode again here in the United States and Europe, and Lord, we ask that you would protect all those who are infected, family members of those who are infected, Lord, that you would enable them to be cared for by doctors, that there would be space for them to be able to recover, help their bodies to overcome the illness. God, we pray for those who are not sick, that you would give wisdom to each of us as we attempt to protect not only ourselves, but to protect our neighbors. Help us to have resiliency and strength to do what is best for everyone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those in need today, Father, we lift up to you many whom we have spoken of today. We thank you that Leanne Lugodensky is back home. As she continues to recover from COVID, we pray you would give her new strength each and every day. And we lift up to you a number of people, Steve Powers and John Sheely, Beth Andrews' sister Nancy, Lane Froelich, Mike Baruvka, Wayne Heinrich, Corey Nitsky, Steve Lambert, Helen Seafeld, Dottie Ellingson. Lord, we pray that you would, in each of the ways that these individuals are battling a health concern, we ask that you would make yourself present in this battle by healing them, by strengthening them, by giving them hope and strength to carry on, to carry forth. Lord, we pray for Tasha Schweiger and her family as they are grieving the loss of two grandfathers this week. Lord, I pray that you would comfort them. Comfort them in your love, in your kindness. And Lord, for those who are in need today, for those with chronic illnesses, for those with mental illnesses, for those with things that they carry close to who they are, but they know that, Lord God, they have need of you. God, pray that you would meet those needs, that you would come into the lives of these people, of all of us. Help us each and every day to rely upon you, to live in your grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And for this church, Lord God, I thank you for the work that you do continue to do here. Although it be an odd time and a space where we're not together, Lord, I do feel like we're together very much. And I appreciate the opportunity to continue to minister, even though it be from a remote location. Lord, I pray that you would bless each person as they've heard these words from Scripture today, as they've heard these songs and sung along, as they've heard the message, that you would go, that it would be with, that would be a seed in each person's heart and draw them closer to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Before I give the benediction today, I just want to... I haven't in now probably over a month shared or given this reminder, but I do want to remind you that even though we don't have an offering time in the service and we don't pass the plate around in our family here for us all to virtually give money, although we're meeting virtually, virtual money won't cut it. And so I want to ask you to consider to continue to give as you have given. So faithfully through this time. For those of you who are members of the church, I'm not asking those who are able to join us from remote locations necessarily, but for those of you who are members, who are regular attendees, however you want to put it, just please consider giving to the church in a form of offering, and you can mail a check to the church website, or not the website, to the church mailing address, and that can be found on the website. So, with that though, I'll close with a benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Have a great week. See you back next week.
I'm gonna stop it. Ready? Stop it.
Push that.